Yeah, right.
I'm up for an adventure.
Well, and that's what actually Emily Dickinson says, is that, like, Rebecca to Jerusalem, and she's it's like the country girl going to the big city, like,
right.
The awe of...
gonna see the world.
I guess more than Isaac, even, it was going to Jerusalem.
So wouldn't it be funny if we heard it from her point of view, and it was like, you know, all along, what's his name? What's the servant's name?
Oh, it doesn't say here, but his name's Eliezer, but I don't think it's in the text.
Oh, yeah,
text,
yeah. Okay. All along he's thinking, you know, that this has been orchestrated because it's, you know, it's Abraham and Isaac's wishes or whatever, you know.
Right.
But in reality, it was Rebecca praying, you know, please
right, yeah.
send someone to get me out of here. You know, I'll know him when I see him if he asks me to, you know, give him a sip from my jug.
That's
you know?
Great.
I mean,
that's
can
hysterical.
You imagine if it was like...
Because Eliezer gets in trouble, actually, for saying that, it doesn't say in the text, but in the Midrashim it says he gets in trouble for saying, oh, the first one who comes and waters my camels and does this, because the point is, well, what if she's blind, and maybe she... And then you're excluding somebody from God's choice. But mm-hmm. maybe it was Rebecca's prayer,
yeah.
not Eliezer's that did it.
She's like, all right, I'm gonna come out with my jug. And
that's hysterical.
The first guy who asked me for a sip.
Yeah, I'm out of here. That's wild. I wish Anita Diamant had written at the beginning of the Red Tent, we only get Rebecca in her dotage. But Anita Diamant would do the same thing for Rebecca now. You totally could. If you could do it for Dina, you could do it for Rebecca.
But I anyway. So
that's really funny.
It's funny to think about.
I guess one other thing that jumped out at me is that Isaac takes takes Rebecca into Sarah's tent and
right. Oh,
brings a comfort to her.
That's huge. Just like mom's gone.
Yes.
You fill her shoes now, you know?
Yeah. Totally. And the thing is that that's not just us doing like 21st century gender stuff because Rashi says that yes, because Sarah's gone and so Rebecca and so in Isaac's life, because his mother's gone, he needs a new woman, and Rebecca fills that void in his life. So the idea of wife is like surrogate mother.
Oh yeah.
It's not very manly.
It's classic, though. I mean, it's,
yeah.
I mean, it doesn't get more classic than this, and it hasn't changed much since, I don't think.
But it's not an ideal. I mean, it's not something you want. I mean, because these patriarchs are.
What's not an ideal?
A woman, a wife, just being like, "Well, mommy's gone. Bring in a new one. Like, bring in."
Sounds pretty ideal to me.
I think it sounds ideal to a lot of men, and I don't think that. I mean, I think that they're.
A man wants to be a provider. I mean, not just a material provider, but I don't think. Well, I guess I'll just speak for myself.
Well, no. Then think of it. It's okay. Then think of it this way. It's like you grow up and you mature and you shift from. Your dependency as a little boy on your mother to your partnership as a man
right.
with your wife. And so it's not like, it's not a full-on replacement. You know
right.
what I mean? It's just, it's like, it's the necessary shift to move on. But
right.
it is, I mean, I think, you know, I mean, it's hard not to, I feel like there's always that overlap between like a man's relationship with his mother and his relationship with his wife, and there's always like the conflict that's there and the tension that's there.
Yeah.
And it's just sort of such a natural.
But a wife can't like the mother provides something that you can never ask of a wife, which is like totally unconditional love, and you can't like. I mean, maybe that's why men have been so big on making women chattel, because there's no other way to get them to do what a mother would do, which is just think your shit smells great. Like,
right.
You know, like, right? I mean, it's
yeah.
I don't know. I don't know. I guess, yeah. But I guess why it jumped out at me is because I do look to the patriarchs for ideals to which to aspire, and so when I don't see it.
According to the Art Scroll, to bring in to restore the conversation to the holy.
I've mentioned Rashi like 10 times.
No, you did real good for a guy. The Sidra, meaning the Pasha, according to the Art Scroll here, shows Jewish respect for the dead and concern for the future. These are essential concepts in Judaism. We neither reject what has gone before nor neglect what lies ahead. The narrative begins with the life, with the death of Sarah and Abraham's intense desire to give her a proper burial in a place worthy of her greatness.
So can we talk about respect for the dead?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because, yeah, I mean, that obviously is a running theme throughout this portion as well. And I think it's interesting to see the like, weaving together of that and of concern for the future. Because, you know, I think it's making the point that you sort of have to keep both in mind to be really balanced moving forward.
Right.
And I think that's cool. I think that's really important, and it's probably, like, it's more challenging to achieve than maybe it seems.
But yeah, that's exactly right, because that's what they do. They you start off with burying the Sarah who's gone, and then immediately it turns to doing what he thinks he needs to do to ensure a good future, which
and
is
for so, that. Actually, that might relate to exactly what you just said about Isaac bringing Rebecca into Sarah's tent, because maybe it's like that's a symbol of his saying, I'm moving forward with you, but in doing so, I'm not forgetting my mother and everything that she represents and everything that she means, and we're sort of like taking her with us as we move forward without her physically.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know.
That makes perfect sense. I like
it.
Yeah,
like we're housing ourselves in her memory and in her history. And
I like that way better than Rashi's interpretation. I do.
What was Rashi's interpretation?
Well, Rashi's was that, you know, the a man needs a woman, and first you have your mother, and then once the mother's gone, Rebecca just becomes the surrogate mother.
And
so
I think that's obvious. Like, yes, sure, that's a basic part of, like, living. We grew up with our mom and dad, and eventually we move on from mommy and daddy to husband or wife or whatever.
Right.
Sure, obviously.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, to point out that this is a portion that's really focused on those two things together at the same time.
Right. Yeah. To me, that's a perfect that reading works perfectly, and it's just preferable. Yes, because it's honoring the past without trying to force, in this case, Rebecca to be exactly what you liked about the past, which is the mother. So yeah, I mean, it's an honoring of the past while moving forward. I dig it. Somebody get that.
I dig it.
Somebody amend Rashi text.
Okay, according to the Art Scroll, at 100, Sarah was as sinless as a 20-year-old, for until the age of 20, a person does not suffer heavenly punishment.
Ooh.
At 20, she still had the wholesome beauty of a 7-year-old who does not use cosmetics and whose beauty is natural. Rabbi Moshe Feinstein commented that a child's beauty is pure and is never used to tempt others to go astray. Part of Sarah's greatness was that despite her breathtaking beauty as an adult, all who saw her recognized her purity and innocence.
Come on, fellas.
You buy that? Have you ever seen, like, a really beautiful woman and said, wow, I recognize her purity and innocence?
I look into your eyes and I see the 7-year-old you once were.
I got bad news for you guys. You find a woman and you see all that purity and innocence, you're missing something. There's nobody's pure and innocent. I mean, you're trying to get women to conform to that? Like, good luck, fellas. You like, it's unfair, don't you think? Like that.
Yeah, I mean, do you think that's sort of being written and presented as like, something to aspire to?
I think
certainly Judaism and the art school.
But I got to say, when I saw Helen at the Juicy Party, I immediately thought, this is a woman, despite her breathtaking beauty, I recognize her purity and innocence.
Well, I cede you that pleasure, and it's a wonderful thing, but
maybe I'm just at such a high level that I'm able to...
Right,
you're
transcendental. I think you... Yes, yes, because you have great access to people's spiritual nature, and so that's what...
But thank you, it's good to know. It is.
No, but come on, isn't that problematic? I think it is. I think that's...
Yeah, when the good Rabbi Feinstein says the child's beauty is pure and is never used to tempt others to go astray. I don't know how many kids he's known.
I know.
Right, yeah.
It's like...
Learn the hard way, but that's not the case.
That's not the case. I mean, when he says that, that's no different than Ahmadinejad saying, no, in Iran we have no gays. I mean, it's just like... It's like
well,
it's like saying